AIB, in partnership with the National Center for Civil and Human Rights, present The Power to Inspire, a Human Rights Summit, which shines a light on current, pressing human rights issues and solutions from those who are working for their elimination. On this episode, Dr. Nataki Osborne Jelks leads a discussion on our global home. The time is now to take the protection of the earth personally.
To tie in the issue of the protection of our earth with human rights. We know that both human behavior and global warming are things that we hear about in the news quite a bit these days. We hear a lot of issues about energy, about unpredictable weather patterns, about things that are happening globally that are connected to global warming and to climate change. What we rarely hear about are the activists, the people who are on the ground, who are working in real life communities to try to address these issues, to try to mitigate impacts that this human behavior has caused not only to the earth, but to the people who inhabit the planet. So today we have a very distinguished panel who will kind of break into some of these issues. We'll start off with three leaders who have worked for a number of years in the environmental justice field. And they'll talk a little bit about what environmental justice is. They'll make that connection to human rights. And then we'll hear from a younger activist who is working here locally with an organization that is all about engaging youth and making sure that our youth understand what the challenges are that are faced by both our planet and its people and how they can be engaged in making a difference and making a change. So first we'll start with Dr. Robert Bullard, who is the Dean of the Barbara Jordan Mickey Leland School of Public Affairs at Texas Southern University. He's often been called the father of the environmental justice movement, and I affectionately call him my mentor. He is a former professor. I went to school as an undergraduate at Spelman College, and he was right across the street at Clark Atlanta University. He was the Ware chair. I'm getting the name wrong. But he was an environmental sociologist, and he had an endowed chair position in the School of Sociology at Clark Atlanta University, and he was the director of the Environmental Justice Resource Center, which is an organization that has helped many, many, many communities and organizations across the country in their fight to advance environmental justice. So Dr. Bullard is going to kick off the conversation and set the context for us so that we all understand what environmental justice is, and he'll make that connection to human rights. And then we'll move on to Dr. Mildred McClain, who is the founder of Harambee House in Savannah, Georgia. This is a woman who, there just are no words to explain the commitment that she has to environmental justice, how she rolls up her sleeves to work with grassroots communities, but also how she takes kind of an international stage. She is one who speaks truth to power, whoever and wherever that power is. She's been across this world speaking on behalf of communities of color, communities that are devastated by environmental injustices. And she has, and she's also planted very firmly in her home community in Savannah to do work on a daily basis. We next will have Cynthia Peurifoy, who is an environmental justice coordinator with the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. And a lot of times we don't think about our government agencies as playing a major role in some of these community struggles. But there are people like Cynthia who are on the front lines working hand in hand with communities to make sure that they get the resources that they need, that they get the assistance and capacity building help that they need to bring forth healthier, cleaner, and more sustainable communities. And then finally, we'll have McCall Langford, who is the business development director of One More Generation, an organization that was started by two young people. And when I say young people, I mean elementary school-aged children. And she'll talk about the work that One More Generation does and the imperative that they see for youth to be engaged in environmental issues, from climate change to endangered species protection, but to just making sure that youth understand that as global citizens of this world, that if the planet is to be here for future generations, that young people have got to understand what their role is, and they need the tools and the resources to be engaged. So with that, we'll first have Dr. Bullard to come up. Each panelist will speak about 8 minutes, and then we'll have some questions at the close of each of at the close of all of their presentations.
Again, my name is Robert Bullard, and I'm a sociologist by training and an environmental sociologist, and I'm proud to say that I am an environmentalist. I left Atlanta 4 years ago, and when I came back to Atlanta in 1994 from Los Angeles, I was a professor at UCLA, and I wanted to start a center that dealt with environmental issues, that dealt with justice, that dealt with human rights, that dealt with health, transportation, that dealt with justice, environmental justice. Environmental justice embraces the principle that all people are entitled to equal protection of our environmental laws, housing, transportation, civil rights, human rights, energy, health, all those things brought together. And so that center that I started in 1994 at Clark Atlanta grew to become a major research entity, and not just a think tank, but a do tank. The environment is everything. It's where we live, work, play, worship, go to school, as well as the physical and natural world. And what the environmental justice movement has done over the years is to really operationalize the fact that there is a human component in the environment. The humans are not the most important component in terms of an ecological system. It's probably the most destructive part. But when we talk about environment historically and traditionally, the environment was something out there, wilderness, wildlands, the hinterlands, birds, whales, and the human component that's most impacted by the negative externalities of development oftentimes were left out. Most environmental organizations never dealt with poverty, racism, inequality. And for many years, these issues were considered by environmentalists were considered social and were detached from environmentalism, conservation, etc. And so what the environmental justice movement did is to bring those components in. The environment is where we live, work, play, worship, learn, as well as the physical and natural world. The issue of climate, the issue of environment, the issue of access to things that make us healthy, parks and green space, food security, issues of having access to a grocery store, full service where you can get healthy food, the concept of food deserts, food insecurity, not having enough money to buy food. These are not just international, global issues. These are issues that resonate in this country, in this state, and in this city. So when we talk about human rights, the right to breathe clean air is a basic human right. The right to eat food that is not contaminated, is not shot up with all kinds of poison, I'm sorry, toxins, pesticides. And you talk about steroids. The right to breathe clean air, eat food that's clean, and to drink water. These are basic necessities. The right to have safe shelter that is healthy and sustainable, that's not bombarded with lead. And so when we talk about the right for our kids to go outside and play on a playground that's not sandwiched between two refineries, and there are examples like that. I have a great PowerPoint, but I won't speak from the heart. And so when we talk about these issues, when we talk about connecting them to human rights, we are talking about civil rights, you have to understand. And remember that Dr. King went to Memphis, Tennessee in 1968 on a human rights, civil rights, environmental justice mission, striking garbage workers. They were striking for a reason, not because they didn't want to go to work, because their work conditions were intolerable, equal pay, fighting for justice, equality. And Dr. King didn't make it out of that. So when we talk about human rights, civil rights, and expand it to a global context, I can think of no other important human rights issue or the number one environmental justice issue globally is climate change. Climate change is not theory. It's not debatable. Who wants to debate gravity? Gravity exists. So all these deniers, and there are maps that you can show a line of denial by state. And I won't call any names, I won't call any color. Yes, I will. The color is red. If you look at those states and draw the Mason-Dixon line, you can see climate denial. And I have great maps to show denial, concentrated poverty, uninsured, people who are against Obamacare. You start looking at these basic human rights to have quality health care, the right to not, if you get sick, your response is you got insurance or you die. When we talk about climate change, the people that are impacted first, worst, and longest are the communities that have contributed least to global warming. And so when we talk about here in this country, in terms of poor people contribute least to climate change, but we pay the price first, worst, and we talk about where we live, where these coal-fired power plants, where these refineries. If you look at where we live in terms of low-lying areas, areas prone to flooding, the southern United States is very vulnerable to climate change. We have more severe weather events, $2 billion weather events, than any of all the regions combined. When you talk about billion-dollar weather events, we're talking about southern states. Southern states are more impoverished economically than the general society. So when you talk about vulnerability, you talk about where people are concentrated, you talk about the fact that if something happens to a geographic location, will the government respond? We saw Katrina, but it's not just Katrina. If you look at the issues of human rights and the question that a lot of communities are asking, will the government respond in a fair and equitable manner, or will it take its time? When recovery dollars are being spent, when redevelopment dollars are being spent, will those dollars be spent in a way that is fair and equitable? Will the housing be fair and equitable? When the levees are built, will the people who were vulnerable before the storm are the same people, will they be vulnerable after? And the answer to that question is the same people who are oftentimes at risk and vulnerable before disasters happen. These are the same people that are hit hard, the hardest first and worst. So when we talk about justice when it comes to evacuation of transportation, most of the evacuation for disasters depend upon individuals having private automobiles. This is even almost 10 years after Katrina. If we would have to evacuate Atlanta, God forbid, of some disaster, almost 35% of the folks in this city do not own a car. And so when we talk about can you get to where you need to get to on MARTA if there's a major disaster? Can you depend on the public transit system to get you out of here if there's a disaster? We're not just talking about physical, natural disasters. We're talking about economic disasters also. In the downturns in the economy, the people that are hurt most are the people who have very marginal incomes, very vulnerable populations that are living on the margins. So economically, you can have a slow-moving disaster, and if you have a natural disaster, it's compounded. These are basic human rights. When you talk about you seeing floods and typhoons and earthquake, the most vulnerable before those disasters, those are the people who it takes longer when we talk about resilience. So the environmental justice movement, I'm going to wrap up because I know I don't have a lot of time. The environmental justice movement and the climate justice movement is trying to pull those pieces together, connect those dots to talk about every community has a right to be safe, sustainable, healthy, and livable. Even if that community is on the other side of the tracks, or if it's on the south side, on the west side, or on the side where it has not received its fair share over the years. And so what the environmental justice movement is an equalizer. It has research methodologies. It has science. It has climate science, and it also has sociology and political science. A lot of the inequalities that occur in our society is not based on science. Well, it is based on science. It's political science. Who gets what, when, where, and why? And so what the environmental justice movement has tried to do is unearth those inequalities and develop strategies, real strategies, bottom up, working with communities. You know, being a college professor, I don't parachute into any community uninvited. But being an ex-Marine, when I get invited, you know, I don't parachute in. I take Delta and go in and take Martin and get to where I need to go. But the idea is that we have lots of communities working on these issues. We have government working in partnership, and we have young people. The final thing I'd like to say, we have a historically black college university consortium working on climate issues, environmental issues. That stretches from Texas all the way up to Maryland. Morgan State all the way down to Louisiana and Texas. We're working with our young students and pairing those students with communities, forming a community university partnership, doing community-based participatory research, action-oriented, solution-oriented research, because our universities have to be relevant and they have to get us young people involved. It's training the next generation of leaders, and that's what I do. And I'm very good at it because I'm looking at one of my products. Thank you.
Gonna let nobody turn me round, turn me round, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, I'm marching up to freedom's land. Ain't gonna let no environmental injustice turn us around. Oh, Lordy, turn us around. Turn us around. Ain't gonna let no environmental injustice turn us around. We gonna keep on fighting, keep on teaching, keep on training, keep on inspiring, working for our human rights. I come and bring greetings from a very small coastal city town, an old southern plantation called Savannah, Georgia, where our population is, depending on who you speak with, is anywhere from 150,000 to 175,000, and depending on who you talk to, we are anywhere from 50 to 65 to maybe 70% African American. I've been an organizer since I was 13, and I'm going on since I'm something, and it hasn't been an easy journey. I have been asked to speak a little bit about and briefly about community organizing and its role in inspiring us, in motivating us, in moving us toward the protection and the preservation and the sustaining of human rights. I have a right to breathe. And right now in Savannah, it's so hard for me to breathe because of the large incidence of asthma amongst our school-aged children, because some of the neighborhoods that I work with in Savannah, they have about 300 residents, and they live in a donut circle of about 17 polluting industries. And these three neighborhoods that we work in, Hudson Hill, Woodville, and West Savannah, have for decades been asking for someone to stand up for their right to breathe, their right to good food, their right to clean water, their right to a healthy, safe, and sustainable neighborhood, and no one answered. As our princess said earlier, we have been, all of us, from Savannah to Selma, from Selma to Soweto, from Soweto to Copenhagen, from Copenhagen to Costa Rica, to Nicaragua, to Uniontown, Mississippi, with one battle cry. We are sick and tired of being sick and tired. But most of all, we are sick and tired of dying from illnesses and health effects and catastrophes that can be avoided. And yes, we have our eyes on climate change because as a coastal community, a coastal neighborhood, when the sea rise, when that ocean heat up, a lot of our citizens who are vulnerable as they are labeled because they are young, they're old, they're poor, they're disenfranchised, they're marginalized. Like Dr. Bullard said, they won't even know where the emergency exit is. Because a couple of years ago, there was an accidental spill from the International Paper Company of something called 410. And they released so many pounds of it that the workers at the plants had to be evacuated, but all 300 residents of Hudson Hill had to sit still. They didn't even know what was going on because they didn't know what the siren sounded like that would make them aware that there's a disaster, there's an accident. You got to get out of town. You got to get out of your neighborhood. And when they asked the policeman and the fire department what was going on and what should they do, the answer was, I don't know. You just have to stay in your house. What? So we work with these small neighborhoods trying to build their capacity to be able to have voice, because when we entered the environmental justice movement, we said we speak for ourselves. We have passion, but with people like Dr. Bullard and people like Cynthia Peurifoy, we were able to arm ourselves with data. So we are now data and evidence driven. So we don't just jump up on the table because we mad and angry and all that. We jump up on the table and we say we got these documents to prove it. No, we are not epidemiologists, but we know that this to be true. There's a correlation, there's a relationship, there's a connection, there's a link, there's something going on in here. Something is affecting our health to the point that the largest indicator of absenteeism in Savannah is due to asthma. That's why they're out of school. And yet they live in these 17 polluting industries and nobody wants to do anything. But let me get back to just telling you a little bit, power to inspire. There's power in just one or two of us. The scriptures tell us that sometimes it's better to have three than 300. Because if you got three well-committed, purpose-driven, mission-oriented people, you don't need 300. You're going to do the work of 300. But now it's coming of age that we need more boots on the ground, boots in the trenches, boots in the White House, boots in the government house, boots in the academic institutions that understand the relationship between the citizens and the residents that they serve. Because we all drink water. When was the last time you didn't drink no water? But I don't have the water to come out my tap, I can't drink it. Then I don't got the money to buy that kind of expensive water. I don't have the money to put a filter on my tap so I can get alkaline water. That thing costs $4,000. I have a human right, and my human right is to breathe clean air, to be able to access clean vegetables and fruits, to be able to put my little garden out in the yard without having a raised bed because I got arsenic and lead in the soil. But there's a difference between organizing and mobilizing, because we are good at mobilizing. You can see that around the country today. Life matters. Hands up. I can't breathe. That's mobilizing. Organize is on the ground all the time, every time, 24/7. And it's a lifelong commitment. Organizing is the backbone of change. It is that which we will be able to accomplish our human rights and, like Nelson Mandela, see change in our lifetime. We must understand the nature of our struggle, our fight, our work, our mission, because we must educate, we must agitate, we must organize. That's where inspiration comes from. We must recognize the difference between reform and change, policy, process, and practice. Because now we're in the 22nd century of having to inspire people who have fallen asleep. Because if you're 65, you're ready to retire. But we can't pass off the baton yet until we build the capacity of our young people to harness that great creativity, that great energy they have, and to move this train on down the tracks. I'm going to end with the pea soup. I call it the ingredients for effective organizing and inspiring people to fight for their human rights. Well, this is a human rights summit, and thank you so much, Dr. Richardson, for all of your work. We celebrate your one-year anniversary. But as we move forward, looking at climate justice, looking at environmental justice, economic justice, social justice, racial justice, I submit to you that in order to have power to inspire, you have to have purpose. You have to be clear on what your purpose is, and you can't get tired of your purpose. It may get refined, but you must have purpose, and then you must have people, people that are on the ground engaged in the process, and they're participating. And then you must be able to persevere like Dr. Bullard did when they would no longer entertain his genius at Clark Atlanta University, had to persevere as he moved to Texas and then be able to keep the connection. We must have power because power speaks to power and power understands power. Come up there wimping, talking about, I want my environmental justice and see what happened to you. You better throw your fists up in the air and act like you do care. And then with that power, what we have least of, we must have patience because change is not overnight. I entered this organizing movement at the age 13, and like I said, next Monday I'll turn 67. Glory to God, and I'm still on the front line, and I ain't going nowhere yet. But we must have patience, patience with our young people to allow them to make their mistakes, to do their thing, and then come back and mentor them, and to make sure that they're in the room and on the boards and at the table and have their own voice, not our voice, their voice. And then we must be ready to protect those elders who go as the frontliners. We must protect those people in the agencies and who are in the academic institutions and the community-based institutions who serve as our champions. We must protect them because they're up against some mighty, mighty forces and enemies within. And then finally, as a spiritual woman, I would be derelict to say that my final P is prayer. For it is in my culture that I start nothing and end nothing without prayer, because it is a higher power that I depend on to do the last P, and that's to produce a product, a tangible product that young people and residents and old people can touch and say, that happened as a result of my work, my purpose, my organizing, my mobilizing, my educating, my agitating, and my stand on the course. We need partners, friends, tools, resources, toolkits, blueprints, champions, commitment, and informed action to get to the finish line. So I would end in saying, keep your eyes on the prize and hold on. Hold on, hold on. Keep your eyes on the prize. And the prize is clean, fresh air as a human right. The prize is good, nutritious food to keep us sustained. The prize is a planet that's free from poison, free from politics. Politics is all right, but when it becomes politricking, it's time for somebody to go home. Your vote matters. So if you're not registered, you better get there. If you're registered, take somebody with you. When you go to vote, don't go by yourself. Pick up your neighbor. Take the person who don't have transportation and y'all walk together. A good walk will be good for you. You can discuss what your next step is in your strategy to preserve and to protect the human rights that our Creator and our universe has afforded us. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. How do you follow Dr. Bullard and Dr. McClain? How did this happen? But these are two of our leading experts, not just in this country, but in the world on environmental justice. And I'm really pleased to be here and be a part of this discussion. I'm going to try to go through a little PowerPoint with you. Ooh. So here we go. So is this the time, should we really care about the earth, or should we take it personally? Is this the time? I say it is, and why? First of all, Dr. Bullard talked a lot about Katrina. We learned so much from Katrina, from the federal government's perspective, from the community's perspective, from local government perspective, that we know we've got to do things different, and we really have been doing a lot of things different. One of the things that took place with us from an environmental justice perspective is we actually had a work group that really looked at Katrina through our National Environmental Justice Advisory Council and made a lot of great recommendations to EPA, which really led to environmental justice having a seat at the table in the entire response process. So there was always someone. Now, when we have a national disaster, there's going to be an environmental justice discussion. I wanted to talk about some communities that I've been dealing with for a long time to give you a perspective of what we go through and how things work. And this is one that has bothered me for a very long time. We have a community up in Rock Hill, South Carolina. It's the Black Monroe community. It's a beautiful little community, a lot of children, but this community doesn't have running water. They don't have electricity. They have a nonprofit that has gone and brought in a bathhouse where the kids can come and everybody in the community can come and bathe. And they also have a community center where the kids are educated every day. We had two grants with this community, and one of them, it was really interesting, we had the county, because we were like, well, why can't you get a water line? Why can't you get a water line? So we paid for a study, getting the water line in. Guess what? They still don't have the water line. And, you know, I think that's what I want to kind of get us to thinking about is, just like we just heard from these folks, these leaders so eloquently, it's basic rights that communities need to have. Here's another one who really hit the nail on the head. I love Omega Wilson up in Mebane, North Carolina, because he coined it correctly. It's all about the rights to basic amenities. Do we have that? Are we getting what we pay for when we pay our taxes? His community went through a long process of really looking at their health and environmental challenges. And they really found that they didn't have some basics. They didn't have safe drinking water. They didn't have a good sewer collection system. They didn't have paved streets or sidewalks. They didn't have adequate stormwater management. And they really, really got into a posture where they worked with the local government to demand these services. And so through that, they have, I know, close to over 100 homes that have been connected now to water and sewer in that area. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the effects of pollution. Do we know the effects that pollution has on our health? And that's what this schematic is all about, to really get you to thinking water pollution, air pollution, soil pollution all impact our health in some way. And here we go to some of the least serious to the more serious, and we all know cancer and nervous system problems, liver, kidney disease are those more serious. And I also wanted you to think about it, and Dr. Bullard really laid it out about the South. We got a problem in the South. All of the data shows when it comes to health, there is a problem. So this is the infant mortality rate. Look at the South and look at the high rates of infant mortality deaths. Diabetes, we know about diabetes. It is really horrible in the South. It's one of the leading causes of death. And strokes, I mean, we know strokes are just something that really exacerbates in the minority communities. So I wanted to not be all doom and gloom, and I wanted to share with you some tools that EPA has, and this is one of them here that we have on our website now. And if you pull this up, you can find resources for all type of issues and concerns that you're facing in your community, from transportation to housing to environmental to health. And I really encourage you to take a look at that. Also, I have to share that right now we are in the process of receiving comments on our EJ Action Plan 2020. We have come up with a new plan and new strategies and new priorities to take us through the year 2020. And we're really trying to deepen our approach to EJ within EPA's programs and to really try to improve the health and the environment of the communities we serve. We're also looking at collaboration and the partnerships and really want to expand that with communities. And we're also looking at how we can demonstrate progress and outcomes that matter to communities. I encourage you to go to our website. We're taking comments through June 15th of this year, and we're also setting up special outreach activities related to that. So then I wanted to share with you a success story that I've been a part of, and I'm doing horribly on this. But a lot of folks have heard about the Regenesis Project, and it's up in South Carolina. And this community took a $20,000 EJ small grant, Environmental Justice Small Grant, and grew it into almost $300 million of revitalization for their community. And they did it through working together. They did it through creating their own vision. They did it through not taking no for an answer. They did it through empowering themselves in the political arena, having folks from their organization elected. They did it through partnering with the local government, figuring out what grants were going to be appropriate for their vision. Also working with the local industry. They had a company there that was right in the middle of that community. They wanted out of that community. But rather than forcing the company out, which they really couldn't do, they actually started a dialogue, and now there's a real partnership between that company and the community. So they have really done very well. They have a new center. You know, we talked about food deserts. They were definitely a food desert. They were able to get a Save-A-Lot to come in. They have, I think now, 5 community health centers. They have an incredible amount of new housing through a HOPE 6 grant from HUD. So it can happen, it can be done, it just takes time and it takes commitment. So yes, I say environmental protection is a personal responsibility of all of us. It can be done, we all have to work together, government, community, everyone has to work together to make things happen. It takes time, but it can happen. And again, I really appreciate being here and being invited here today, and I hope my comments have been of help to you. Thank you.
My name is McCall Langford. I am the Director of Development at One More Generation. As mentioned before, One More Generation is an endangered species and environmental nonprofit that was founded by a 7 and an 8-year-old back in 2009. I am 23 years old. Definitely, well, maybe the youngest panelist up here. Maybe. And today I want to talk to you guys about the importance of youth education and the role of protecting our environment. As these amazing people have already stated, it's our responsibility as a community and as a global united citizenship to protect the resources that we have on this beautiful planet. I was fortunate enough to grow up with a family that understood this before its time. I value the importance of protecting our environment simply because my family instilled that in me. And that's not the case for most people my age. We are sitting in a room with a unique audience. You guys already understand the importance of this. A lot of people out there do not. Right now, we are at a very important turning point in the world, in our time, in history. We are walking away from denial and ignorance, and we are stumbling upon understanding and grasping of the importance of protecting our environment. A lot of the adults that have gotten this concept, who have grasped it, have a really difficult time understanding why other adults won't accept the same things that they're accepting. It's been said time and time again, you can't teach an old dog new tricks. You can. It's hard. It's way easier to instill this information in children who soak up information like sponges. So while it's super important for us to rally communities and change the minds of adults, we cannot forget the importance of paying attention to what we are teaching our youth. Our youth, they are the key to solving this issue. My grandfather, who founded a carpet company back in the 70s, which is a heavily petroleum-based manufacturing institute that is extremely damaging to the environment, gained a large fortune and in the early 90s read a book called The Ecology of Commerce by Paul Hawken. He told me that when he read that book, it was like a spear to his chest. He realized that he had been causing problems to the planet on unjust levels of intensity, and that because of these decisions to disregard the environment, he had ruined something for tomorrow's child. So after reading The Ecology of Commerce, my grandfather completely changed the way that Interface, the carpet company that he founded, manufactured carpet tiles. They set this mission called Mission Zero, to have zero emissions and damages to the earth by 2020, and they are on their way to that mission. One day, someone asked my grandfather, what will be the day that we see the shift in our society and in our communities that will save the planet? And his answer was, the day that scholars step into positions of power in our community organizing initiatives, in our school systems, in our manufacturing corporations, and in any large corporate industry, when scholars step into those positions that know the importance of protecting our environment, that will be the day that we see the shift. And so what we need to do is make sure that that happens soon. We want the children who are in our schools now, today, understanding the importance of protecting our environment. And that's a responsibility of the education system. That's the responsibility of our collegiate systems. But it's more so a responsibility of our community. What we put into our schools are what they hear we say we want in our schools. It's your job to talk to your community, to your children, to your children's teachers, to make sure that they realize it's important to protect our environment. So what I want to leave you guys with is a poem that was written after my grandfather said that they were going to make the environmental changes at that corporation that needed to be made. This is a poem called Tomorrow's Child. Without a name, an unseen face, and knowing not your time nor place, tomorrow's child, though yet unborn, I met you first last Tuesday morn. A wise friend introduced us to, and through his sobering point of view, I saw a day that you would see, a day for you, but not for me. Knowing you has changed my thinking, for I never had an inkling that perhaps the things I do might someday somehow threaten you. Tomorrow's child, my daughter's son, I'm afraid I've just begun to think of you and of your good, though always having known I should. Begin I will to weigh the cost of what I squander, what is lost, if ever I forget that you will someday come to live here too. Thank you.
Those inspiring and educational remarks.
Thank you. Lots of work going on in the youth space. We have a question up front first, and then we'll kind of move our way around.
Thank all of you. Wonderful responses. And my question is for the youngest. I really appreciated, whoever wants to answer, I really, really appreciated the thought that you called out scholars. It is the scholars, the men and young boys and girls who will become very critical thinkers within this particular age. 47 years in a classroom, I have a problem with an imposed curriculum, and I feel horrible about the amount of time, the amount of effort I, as an educator, had to put into creating an opportunity for kids to repeat what someone has said. My question is very particular. How do we get school boards? How do we get state education offices, federal education offices, to unleash environmental education as a norm, as a goal, as one of those codes in which I will have the freedom, or teachers will have the freedom, to teach? We're wasting an awful lot of time in schools, and I'm not sure that the product, as a matter of fact, I wonder if the product we're producing is to keep them from knowledge.
Oh, you have a great question.
Right. McCall? That's a really good question, actually. I am a graduate of Georgia State University, and I was a marketing student there. And I had to go through a capstone class that was called Marketing Problems. And the professor matched the classroom with an outside entity, any nonprofit corporation, you name it, small business, where they brought to us a marketing issue, and the class had to solve it operating as a marketing consultancy firm. We had the opportunity to work with an environmental nonprofit that wanted to raise awareness of environmental issues on campus. And through working with that class, we set the school up with a program that ASHU puts on, and it's called Teaching the Teacher. Professor Bach, did you go through the... So the way that the program is set up is any subject that you are teaching, they try to help you intertwine sustainability into the curriculum. So there are outlets out there. It's the professors needing to push the school systems to implement those into their schools. So the answer's out there. It's just, do the universities want the answer? And the beauty of that is that, at least in this area, which is amazing because we're in the South and we're behind in the progressive movement of sustainability. At least here, the schools have been responding to it. Georgia Tech is doing amazing work with implementing sustainability into the classroom regardless of what the subject is. Yeah, so and Emory University, Keenett Howitt has done some amazing in-house work with the universities that have changed the way that they build buildings on campus, the way that they collect water, the way that they're growing food. But it's not just what's going on at the university, it's the students interacting with these projects. So they're creating these hands-on learning experiences for these students. Agnes Scott's done some really cool work too. So, I mean, and I don't have an extensive background in universities outside of this area, but there are programs, there are answers, and it's amazing that you're sitting here asking about this, because that's what we want to hear. We want to hear professors that have been in the classroom, that know that there's an issue, bringing that issue up so that we can give you answers. So thank you for bringing that question up.
Yeah, I'd like to add also, it's not just sustainability on campus. It's not just sustainability, it's just sustainability. I wrote a book called Just Sustainability Development in an Unequal World, MIT Press 2003. Wrote that book after the World Summit on Sustainability. If you look at colleges and universities, school boards, they're very conservative. And if you're looking to get the answer to dealing with just sustainability, because we can have sustainable campuses sitting in the middle of unsustainable communities. If the campus wall is not breached in terms of spillover into the community, you have an island. And that's what's happening in a lot of these places. Some of the greenest campuses across this country are sitting in the middle of some of the most unsustainable communities in the world. And so what the environmental justice movement has been saying for the last 30 years, and what I've been saying for the 30 years, and at least 18 books that I've written, is basically that if we are to connect the dots, we have to, if we're to create sustainable, just, livable, healthy, resilient communities, we have to deal with inequality. That's the key to all of this, whether it's Baltimore, whether it's Ferguson, whether it's Atlanta, whether it's Miami, Houston. The social inequality will take all of us down. And if you look at this whole concept that if you try to create a green city and don't deal with the legacy issues that somehow are oftentimes swept under the rug, and you can have it green, but if you don't deal with that darker shade of green, that racism, that sexism, that geographic isolation, where the jobs have moved to one area, there's no transportation to get to the other area, the people without skills, the schools are not training, educating people for liberation, liberating ideas, being creative. School boards, a straight jacket curricula, and if you teach to the curricula, you get the cheating, you get the problems of miseducation. Now that's what, you know, I'm a sociologist, and I tell people I don't do dead white man sociology. I do what's called scientifically kick-ass sociology. So it's out of the book. It's away from that traditional theme. You know, so you have to do something that's almost like guerrilla warfare in terms of educating. You're saying this, but you're really saying this. We have to unleash the creativity of our minds, and if we do that, I think we can solve a lot of the problems that cut across all of this stuff.
Thank you. Before that question, I just wanted to mention, because there was a list of the institutions locally who are doing a lot in the sustainability space, I just wanted to mention that my alma mater, Spelman College, was just named last week on the Princeton Review's annual guide to green colleges. We are the first historically black college to be on that list. And as Dr. Bullard was saying, it can't just stop with what's going on the campus. It has to extend into the community. And Spelman is doing, or at least trying to do quite a bit in terms of an initiative called Project Impact to work with the surrounding communities to extend that sustainability out into the community and not just to keep it on campus. So I just wanted to give that little plug for Spelman. And now we'll have your question.
Sure. Good afternoon. I guess my question is directed to Dr.
Bullard.
Bullard, I'm sorry, and Dr. McClain. I read a book a couple years ago by a scientist, and he basically posed the question, what's the difference between a problem and a predicament? He said a problem is something that we have a solution for, and a predicament is something that has outcomes. From your perspective, in our current issue with climate change, environmental racism, et cetera, do we have a problem, or are we in a predicament with these situations?
I say we have challenges, and we have opportunities. That's my model. I wrote that book. We have to turn these challenges into opportunities. This is a great time for us to exert leadership in the world.
I want to bring back Chandra Pope, managing partner of Rooted LLC, which is a locally based consulting firm that works at the intersection of environmental justice, energy, and climate issues. And she's going to kind of give us a call to action. We can't let you leave without challenging you. And I know that our panelists have really already done that. So her job is going to be very easy to give us a few pointers to keep us thinking. Beyond today, you know, how can we take what we've learned today and put it in action in our local communities, wherever we are, with the resources, with the tools that we have? And so I'll bring Chandra up, and then Deborah will come back and officially close us out.
Thank you, Nataki. And you're exactly right. I think the panel did an excellent job of doing a call to action to the group, and so my remarks will be very short and brief. But I did just want to say thank you to our panelists for the information and the insights and the expertise that you brought to this discussion today. You know, we did have an opportunity to hear from academia, activists, and our government about how to be engaged in this movement to protect and preserve our planet. And so it's one thing to come to an event like this and to hear and to see, but it's another thing to actually walk out the door and do something about it. This came to mind when Dr. Bullard said that, you know, it's not just a think tank, it's a do tank. So what are you gonna do? Are you just gonna think about the issue? Or are you actually gonna do something? The person in front of us earlier said, you know, I came from California and now I'm in Alabama, Montgomery, Alabama. And, you know, we're thinking about the place in which we live, and we are all experts of our own communities. And so while the panelists shared a lot of different ways that they've entered into this work, we figure out what resonates with you and what's important to you and how what matters to you will be connected to the work and to this movement. And so, again, I'm really excited to be here. I hope that you all were also able to learn a lot about the connections between our basic human rights and environmental justice and environmentalism, and that you will take that information and that you will be inspired to go out and to do something impactful and powerful with your communities.